From the dawn of humanity, the moon has been a mirror of our dreams, an eternal presence in the night sky. We have built myths and legends around it, worshipped it as a goddess, and imagined it as an unreachable kingdom. In Greek mythology, Artemis, the goddess of the moon, protected nighttime travelers and guided hunters through the darkness. In China, the legend of Chang'e told the story of a woman who, after drinking an elixir of immortality, floated up to the moon, leaving her beloved behind on Earth. Across cultures, the moon was not only believed to control the tides, but also to shape the fate of humankind. But as time passed, the moon ceased to be just a mystical symbol. It became a scientific enigma, a challenge waiting to be conquered. In the second century, the astronomer Ptolemy argued that the moon was a giant sphere close to Earth. In the 17th century, Galileo Galilei observed its surface through a telescope and discovered mountains and craters, proving that it was not a perfect sphere, but a world with its own geography. As science advanced, so did imagination, and it was through literature that humanity first traveled to the moon. Long before NASA astronauts even existed, writers had already envisioned what a journey to the moon might be like. In 1865, Jules Verne published From the Earth to the Moon, a remarkably accurate story about a lunar expedition. In his tale, a massive cannon fired a manned capsule toward the moon. And while this seemed like pure fantasy, the concept of a launch from Florida and an ocean landing became a reality over a century later with Apollo 11. In 1901, H.G. Wells published The First Men in the Moon, in which the protagonists discovered that the moon was inhabited by strange creatures. While science eventually dismissed this idea, the novel inspired generations to wonder what secrets our satellite might hold. Then, in 1902, French filmmaker Georges Méliès brought the moon to the big screen with his legendary film, A Trip to the Moon, one of the first great works of science fiction cinema. These stories not only fueled the imagination of the public, but also inspired future scientists, engineers, and astronauts. What was once a literary dream was now about to become a real objective. By the mid-20th century, humanity moved from imagining space to conquering it. Technology had advanced enough to turn science fiction into reality. But space exploration did not begin as a peaceful dream. It started as a competition, the Cold War. The United States and the Soviet Union were not only rivals in military and political power, but also in the race for space dominance. And in this race, the USSR took the lead. In 1957, the Soviet Union shocked the world by launching the first artificial satellite. Sputnik 1 was a simple metallic sphere with antennas, but its success proved that reaching space was possible. This event sent shockwaves through the United States, triggering a crisis in its perception of technological and military superiority. The government responded swiftly. On July 29, 1958, President Dwight D. Eisenhower signed the National Aeronautics and Space Act, officially establishing NASA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, which began operations on October 1, 1958. From its inception, the agency had a clear mission: to develop advanced space technology and secure America's leadership in space exploration. When John F. Kennedy took office in 1961, NASA faced its greatest challenge yet, the Apollo program. After the Soviets successfully sent cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin into space on April 12, 1961, Kennedy knew the US needed an even greater goal. His response was bold: to land a man on the moon before the decade was over. On May 25, 1961, Kennedy made his historic announcement, making Apollo NASA's primary mission and marking the beginning of one of the greatest feats in human history.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
To achieve this goal, NASA had to overcome enormous technological challenges. a rocket powerful enough to escape Earth's gravity was needed, along with a spacecraft capable of reaching the moon and returning safely, and a life support system to ensure astronaut survival. NASA developed revolutionary technology. Each Apollo mission tested new ideas, refining the path toward the moon landing. In 1965, the Gemini program played a crucial role in preparing for the lunar mission, testing the first spacewalks, docking maneuvers, and human endurance in space. However, the road to success was also marked by tragedy. In 1967, the Apollo 1 mission suffered a fatal fire during a ground test, taking the lives of astronauts Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Roger Chaffee. This disaster forced NASA to completely redesign the Apollo capsule and improve safety measures. Despite the setbacks, the program pressed forward with key missions. Apollo 7 successfully tested the control system in Earth orbit. In December 1968, Apollo 8 became the first crewed mission to orbit the moon. Astronauts Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, and Bill Anders circled the moon 10 times and captured the famous Earthrise photograph, showing our planet rising over the lunar horizon. Apollo 9 tested the lunar module maneuvers, and Apollo 10 conducted a full dress rehearsal for the moon landing. With every trial, NASA was one step closer to achieving the impossible. Now, they were ready for the final mission, Apollo 11.
11, 10, 9, ignition sequence start, 6.
On July 16, 1969, the massive Saturn V rocket lifted off from Cape Canaveral, carrying Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, and Michael Collins aboard Apollo 11. Saturn V, a 110-meter-tall beast, taller than the Statue of Liberty and heavier than 400 elephants combined, roared into the sky with unimaginable force. The masterpiece of Wernher von Braun, the genius behind this giant, performed flawlessly. Its first stage burned over 2 million liters of fuel in just 2 minutes. Pure energy, a pillar of fire propelling the astronauts beyond Earth's boundaries. 12 minutes after liftoff, the rocket's final stage placed Apollo 11 into Earth's orbit. The third stage then reignited, pushing them toward the moon. Traveling at more than 40,000 kilometers per hour, Apollo 11 became the fastest machine ever built by human hands. For 3 days, Collins, Aldrin, and Armstrong watched as Earth shrank into a distant blue sphere. There was no turning back. The moon loomed closer, an unexplored and possibly dangerous world. Inside the spacecraft, the astronauts entrusted their lives to a small yet revolutionary computer, the Apollo Guidance Computer, designed by Margaret Hamilton and her team. This device, with less computing power than a modern smartphone, would guide them through the most critical landing in history.
Eagle, Houston, we
the lunar module Eagle separates from the command module. Armstrong and Aldrin are about to descend. Collins, orbiting above, watches them drift away, knowing that if anything goes wrong, they won't be able to return. The onboard computer starts issuing alerts. 1202 alarm. What does that mean? Houston isn't sure. But Armstrong and Aldrin continue. There's no time for hesitation. The Eagle is descending too fast. Armstrong looks out the window. They can't land there. The site is filled with boulders. He has to take manual control. With only 20 seconds of fuel remaining, Armstrong finds a flat area. With superhuman precision, he slowly lowers the Eagle. Gently, carefully, until...
The Eagle has landed.
It is July 20th, 1969. 4 days have passed since launch. Across the world, streets are empty. Shops have closed early. Bars have stopped serving drinks. And in homes everywhere, televisions and radios are turned on. This is a unique moment, an event never seen before. Humanity is about to set foot on another world, and no one wants to miss a single second. From Times Square in New York to remote villages in Africa, from family living rooms to military barracks, the entire planet holds its breath. More than 600 million people watch in black and white as the grainy images are transmitted from the moon's surface. Never before have so many eyes been fixed on a single event. The hatch of the lunar module opens. Neil Armstrong, in his white suit and golden visor, slowly descends the ladder. Television broadcasters, their voices trembling with emotion, narrate each moment. In the United States, Walter Cronkite, the country's most respected journalist, removes his glasses and smiles as the screen shows the silhouette of Neil Armstrong stepping out of the lunar module. In the Soviet Union, where transmissions are limited, some radio operators manage to pick up NASA's signals and secretly share the news. In the United Kingdom, France, Japan, every corner of the world, people are glued to their televisions, witnessing a moment that transcends borders and political rivalries. Neil Armstrong lifts his boot and touches the lunar surface. For the first time, a human being is standing on another world. The moon, the dream of entire civilizations, has finally been conquered. The reaction is immediate. In some places, people erupt in applause. In others, absolute silence fills the room, as if no one can fully process what just happened. Some cry, some embrace, some simply cannot take their eyes off the screen. It is a moment that redefines what it means to be human. Children watch in awe, dreaming of a future where space travel is common. Adults, many of whom grew up in a time when the idea of reaching the moon was mere science fiction, can hardly believe what they are seeing. Emotion mixes with disbelief. Is this real? Some ask. Have we really made it there? Minutes later, Buzz Aldrin joins Armstrong. He looks at the desolate landscape and describes it as magnificent desolation. There is no life, no wind, only the sun's glare reflecting off the lunar dust. Armstrong and Aldrin begin their work. They install a seismometer to detect potential moonquakes. They place a laser retroreflector, a device that will allow scientists to measure the exact distance between the Earth and the Moon, an experiment that even today continues to provide data. They also deploy a series of instruments to study solar radiation and the composition of the lunar soil. Every action, every experiment, is one more step in the conquest of space. Then they carry out one of the mission's most symbolic moments, planting the American flag on the lunar surface. It is a solemn gesture, an affirmation of human achievement beyond the confines of Earth. But there is a problem. The lack of atmosphere prevents the flag from waving, so it remains extended thanks to a horizontal rod. When they take off, the thrust from the lunar module's engines will cause it to fall, leaving only its trace in history. Time is limited, and the mission must go on. Using specialized tools, the astronauts begin collecting soil and rock samples. These are fragments of an unknown world, remnants of a past that could reveal secrets about the moon's origin and the history of the solar system. In total, they gather more than 21 kilograms of material, which will be meticulously analyzed upon their return to Earth. As they work, they document every moment. With their cameras, they capture hundreds of photographs, some of which will become the most iconic images of space exploration. But there is one final message they must leave behind. At the base of the lunar module, they place a commemorative plaque with an inscription that reads, "Here, men from the planet Earth first set foot upon the moon, July 1969, AD, we came in peace for all mankind. A timeless testimony that this was not just an American achievement, but a triumph for the entire human race. The next day, newspapers around the world carry headlines that are nearly identical. Man on the moon. Humanity has reached the stars. Earth has touched another world. On the radio and television, experts debate what this achievement truly means. Some see it as the dawn of a new era in exploration, others as the pinnacle of the Cold War. But regardless of perspective, one thing is clear: the world will never be the same again. But not everyone celebrates. Some have doubts. Some believe the images look too perfect, too cinematic. In the years that follow, conspiracy theories will emerge, voices claiming that the entire event was staged. Yet, on that night, July 20th, 1969, humanity, if only for a brief moment, set aside its differences to look together in the same direction, the moon. After completing their mission, Armstrong and Aldrin return to the lunar module Eagle. Exhausted, they rest for a few hours before departure. Orbiting above, Michael Collins waits patiently in the command module Columbia, knowing that his mission will not be complete until his crewmates return. With surgical precision, the lunar module's engines ignite, lifting the astronauts off the moon's surface, leaving behind their footprints in the gray dust. They dock with Collins, and together they begin the journey back to Earth. 3 days later, Apollo 11 splashes down in the Pacific Ocean, where they are recovered as heroes. They have accomplished the impossible. The Apollo program was not just a victory in the Cold War, it forever changed human history. The technology that took humankind to the moon propelled the future: computers, telecommunications, GPS, space materials. It all began here, with this journey. More than 50 years later, NASA is preparing to return to the moon with the Artemis program, setting its sights on a new horizon, Mars. Now the question is no longer whether we can go back to the moon, but what we will find there this time.